Welcome to Smart Money. I'm Julia Anderson. This is Pat Boyle, my co-host. And we are so excited. We have tech guru Bill Sikkens with us today. And we've been chatting about various things. And something that we're going to get into is phishing and some of the other scams that can go on related to the internet. So I guess right out of the gate, what is phishing?
Phishing is an age-old thing that has moved to the internet in recent years. We saw it by mail and different type of things before. And 10,000-foot definition of it is just a way where the bad guys try to get your personal information by tricking you into thinking they're not the bad guys. And that's the best definition I can give of it. Some specific examples will be an email that looks like it comes from someone legitimate. Your bank account has been blocked. You need to change your password. Mm-hmm. Click here to do it. It looks like it came from your bank. And you click on it, and it's really going to another website that's designed to steal your personal information. And that's one example. There's a lot of different ways of doing it.
Does ransomware come under phishing?
Ransomware comes under phishing.
Okay.
When you click on it, you maybe go to a place that has that type of software that installs on your computer, and now they're able to keylog or something, see what you're doing, all of that type of thing. They do it because it works. And anybody that's been a victim of this shouldn't feel bad, because yours truly included.
It happens. Have you been a phishing scam recipient?
Not phishing, but I had a good friend who ran a business who got ransomware, and he was really mad about it, so he tried to fight back.
Ooh.
Big mistake.
Yes.
I mean, he was locked out of his computer for days.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Getting it back. It was terrible.
Well, the thing that impresses, well, not scares me, I guess would be a better word. I look at emails, your Chase bank account. I'm not a Chase person, but these emails look so professionally done.
They've gotten very good at it. And that's the whole thing. They'll send it out to bulk of people. And no, not everybody is going to be an account holder at Chase or U.S. Bank or whatever it happens to be. But enough are that they're hitting enough people that actually do and would think that it is a legitimate email, that it's worth doing.
So like
doing
one
that.
Out of 100 of their blanket email they've sent.
Yeah. And big ones that have this are things like PayPal, Apple.
Oh.
Those type of things that aren't a multitude of banks, where a lot of people, the majority of people online, have a PayPal account. So it's like, okay, my PayPal account's been blocked. That's a bad thing. I better click here and do it. You get busy. You don't think about it. You click on it, and then all of a sudden they have your password and access to your financial information.
Well, in the words of Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, I borrow this line, who are these guys?
Okay. That's a big question. You have the bad guys, as I call them, all over the world. Now, the FBI just shut down a ring out of Europe and out of Russia.
Oh.
They are trying to
keep on
lately?
Trying.
Just lately. This just happened in the last couple of months. And it has helped, but it will come back. There's always somebody to replace them. But what you have is a group of people that sit 24/7 and work on these type of things. Now, security experts, we only have 8 hours a day. So that's one of the big advantages that they have over people that are trying to fight this type of thing and trying to shut it down.
Wow.
They sit around, they figure out different ways to deal with it, but it's also one of their Achilles heel, if you will, to be able to look for this and figure out what's real and what's not. Is number one, they're getting a lot more professional now, but you will still occasionally see things like misspelled words. It just doesn't look right, that type of a thing, and that's one way to be suspicious of it.
This just dawned on me as I was listening to you. Is there a recruitment that goes on in the high-tech security world where maybe they try to get you to go to the dark side? Does that exist?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, there's three kinds of hackers out there, white hat, black hat, and gray hat. And you actually do have ethical hackers, which are people that the companies hire to try to infiltrate their systems and do these type of things to see if they can fall victim to it and then let them know. But there's a lot of money in these things. And which is what, you know, it's based on, of course, is getting your money in a way that they shouldn't. So they go out there and they try to find people that are very good at hacking and that type of a thing. And, well, you can do this if you come over. Now, the only problem is that they are getting very, people are getting very tired of this.
Very tired.
The laws are changing now. So if you do get caught, it's really not worth it. And that's what they're trying to do. But when you have hacker rings that are out of foreign countries, places like Russia, India,
for sure,
and other places, that the laws are not as strict, and even though the
and
laws
the
might exist. Yeah, the Ukraine, big place where these come from. Those areas, you get caught, you might get a fine. You're probably not going to get in any real trouble for it. So that's why they do it. And that's why a lot of this stuff comes out of those places. the internet is worldwide. You can access it from anywhere. So it really doesn't matter what country you're in. You still have access to be able to get on and get these types of information.
Here's a slightly different question for you. So one of the great miracles of my life was being able to take a picture of a freelance check that I just received in the mail and deposit it electronically in my bank account by just taking a picture of it. Is there anything I should be worried about with that, or is there any reason why I shouldn't do that? It happens to be with Wells Fargo,
right,
which I think you've worked for.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. In fact, I started out my security career with them back in the 90s. But yeah, okay, good question, because it's how do you remain secure and how do you know what you're doing is the right thing?
Yeah.
Number one is to go through your bank's app or their website, where you bring it up on your phone or you go to the website by punching in their domain name to the browser. That's a lot more
secure. Say that again. Take that one step at a time.
Let's say you have a Wells Fargo account. We'll just use that as an example. WellsFargo.com is the official site of the bank.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to go and interact with your account, open up your internet browser, Edge, Chrome, whatever you use, and go to WellsFargo.com and log on. Don't go to it through a link you get in an email.
Oh.
Why is that?
The link in the email can be, and in a lot of cases, is fake, but you won't know.
Because it'll look just like it.
It'll look just like it.
Ah.
Now, if you mouse over it and it's not going to WellsFargo.com or wherever it should, that's a way to know. But again, we get busy. We don't always necessarily check that. So when you get the email that your account's been locked down or you want to deposit a check or that type of a thing, go to the app that's official from the bank, or go to their website.
Okay.
And if you log in through that, you're going to avoid 90% of this type of stuff. Depositing the check through the app is actually a very secure way of doing it. It's something I use, and it's actually a very convenient method to be able to go on there.
Oh, it's amazing.
It saves the trip to the bank. It saves all kinds of stuff. The one big problem with that is when you deposit online, your check doesn't go anywhere. You still
right,
have
I
it.
Have to put it in a file.
File, yeah. I put an X at the bottom.
Right.
You know, some way to tell. But keep in mind on checking accounts that the key to get to them is on the bottom of the check. Still very much a security hole that exists out there. One of the last countries that uses checks like that, but it's still part of banking. Okay. So if those checks don't get destroyed, the person that sent you the check, their identity
can... They're the
one
that's vulnerable because that number is down there.
That number is down there, and just with that information, your picture going to the bank for the deposit, that's secure as long as you do it through the app. But
did you do it through the app, Julia?
Oh, yes, I do it through the app.
Good, I won't worry then.
Do it through the app.
And in most cases, it's restricted to that now just because of security. But that check isn't going to a bank. It isn't being taken by somebody, so you still have that in your possession. So it's very easy just, you know, when you're done with records and keeping that to discard it. Just make sure you shred it or tear it up or in some way dispose of it properly, because that information can be and is something hackers look for.
How do you, I'm just sitting here feeling like a sitting duck, how do you not feel like a sitting duck on the internet?
Yeah, identity theft.
Knowledge, that's the one big thing. Making sure that you handle things in the right way. We've already talked about going to it from a link on an email or some other site that you might not be aware of. The second thing though is there's a lot of stuff that happens that we can't control. The big Experian breach that happened about a year ago now, a lot of personal information, I believe it's one out of every two Americans, got compromised on that.
Oh, yeah, it was ridiculous.
It was, and you can't change your Social
ridiculous.
Security number. You can, but it's not easy to do. Those type of things are not something that you directly have control over, and it's just crimes that can happen. So being aware of your financial data is a big deal.
We went in and actually blocked our credit stuff on that site.
And that's a good way to do it.
We didn't want anyone to access it. And then if we ever had to use that again, we'd have to go back and unlock it, which if we can remember to do that.
Yeah.
But
well, you will when your applications decline, but they'll tell you that's why the credit account's frozen. And that's a good idea to do.
Okay.
That's one way to be able to handle it. It adds an extra step when you do need to legitimately use your credit, but someone else isn't as likely to be able to use it. The second thing of it is checking your bank statements online is fine.
And your credit card
And your credit card statements.
I got hacked this summer.
Yep.
Oh.
I had that happen a few years ago. Somebody got a credit card, and we're now finally switching over to the chip cards, which are more secure, but the mag strip, you can go to an electronics store and buy the equipment to make a credit card. For about
incredible.
$45.
Just incredible.
So you get the fake information. The credit card reader is not checking the name. You know, especially if you're like at a gas station or something automated, it just reads the strip. Well, if I get your credit card information through one of these different things, I can make my own magnetic strip, and now all of a sudden I have your credit card. And those type of things are why you really have to watch your account information. It's important to do just anyway, but if you see a series, a bunch of charges that aren't yours and that type of thing, get a hold of your bank or your credit card provider.
They did take care of it for me.
Yeah, and they usually do.
But they managed to burn me for $2,000.
Yeah, and it's very easy to do.
That $1,400 airplane ticket.
That you didn't get to go on.
That I didn't buy.
Well, why not? You can get a free vacation.
Well, I like the fact that you said the way not to feel like a sitting duck is knowledge, and I think we provided some here today. He is a tech guru, Bill Sikkens. You can find him at wearetechnology.com. Thanks for coming in today.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. For more information, go to my website at 60andsingle.com.